Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
O God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works do proceed, give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness, through the merits of Jesus Christ our Saviour.
Amen.
Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this night, for the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
school, Darcy and Grace, have been undertaking a rather epic mission today. Mrs. Pankhurst will correct me if any of this is wrong, but raising funds for a charity in South Africa that they met on the sports tour in the summer, called Door of Hope, I think is the name of it. The two girls have spent the entire day, starting at 4 o'clock this morning, trying to do 100,000 footsteps in a single day. Two of our community, one of whom should be here singing in the choir, but we will give her a pass for today. They are, I think, as we sit here, making their way to the school field, and they will finish, we think, at about 9 o'clock. It might just be at the end, as you're leaving, you might see them looking very tired, probably doing lap after lap of the school field, trying to get up to that 100,000 footstep mark. So I think I just wanted to share that with you tonight and our thoughts with them. I think they are raising money. There is a link that you can find from somewhere.
So in the name of the God who is, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. You know, it was at services of Choral Evensong that I very first learned all my music, so to speak, as a very young person. I joined when I was 8, and I've been to so many Evensongs in my time, but I think that anthem tonight was just beautiful. It really was. And the soloists, I thought, were just superb. It really was quite wonderful. And it just, to me, is a treasury that we have, is it not? Ain't the Book of Common Prayer, but be this wonderful service of Evensong. It's a treasury at the end of the day to bring all our thoughts and concerns and things we want to celebrate and everything else together into this wonderful liturgy. And when we hear it so wonderfully sung, it lifts us to heaven. And you really do that. It's tremendous. In the second reading for this evening, we find Jesus back in the temple. He'd been there before, of course, not least when he was presented in the temple as an infant and acclaimed as the glory of Israel by Simeon in the words that we now know as Nunc Dimittis, and which, of course, we've sung this evening. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word. Because Simeon recognized Jesus. The infant was brought to him in the temple, and he knew who he was. He'd been waiting to see him for a very long time. The prophetess Anna, who was there as well, also in the temple, foretold to Mary and Joseph that this child that they had brought to God's house was to be set for the rising and the falling of many in Israel. Here was one whom the prophets had spoken of long ago, whose life was going to be lived center stage in the full glare of publicity and be the cause of controversy, and whose life and teaching would find adherence and the opposite as well. Those who saw this same person, now a man, and fulfilling the ministry entrusted to him by his father, wanted to hear from the lips of Jesus himself who he was and by what authority he was doing what he was doing. He was the fresh-faced young man from the countryside, from Nazareth, and here he was in the big city, in the temple whose precincts had been looked after for so long by the priests and others. And here he was almost invading their space, and they felt challenged. They needed to know, they wanted to know who this person was and by what authority he was saying these things. Well, Jesus was not going to hand them the answer on a plate. He wanted them to think about it for themselves, and he turned one question into another to them. So turned it right round and asked them a question at the same time. He said, well, what about John? Because John was the great forerunner of Jesus' whole ministry. He said, well, if you're going to ask me about who gives me authority, let's go back to John first and find out who gave him authority. Well, the questioners retreated, and you can just imagine them doing this, because they knew he was going to get them one way or the other with the answer to this one. Because if they actually said, well, his authority is of God, then, of course, Jesus would turn around and say, well, why did you not believe him then? Why did you not turn and repent and move forward in faith? On the other hand, of course, if he actually said, well, this is of human beings, well, then, of course, they would also risk the crowd, because the crowd believed, so many did, that John was indeed of God, and John had a divine mission. A very tricky situation. And, of course, they must have been really horrified. Well, Jesus turned round and said, well, because you haven't told me, I'm not going to tell you either. Well, have you ever been in that situation? I know I have on the odd occasion. And, when that sort of exchange takes place, I'd rather be on the outside and observe it all than be actually part of it. Well, Jesus uses a story, as he so often does, to make a point that included the very questioners themselves. Because in the story that we heard in our second lesson, one son refused to work. Well, you can imagine, can't you, turning to your son and saying, are you going to do this? And you say, no, I'm not going to do it. Well, fair enough. And turned to another one and said, will you do it? And the second son said, oh, yes. But he didn't. And so in pointing us in this direction, Jesus makes various points. He says, you know, to start with, he said, it's not what we say that we'll do, but it's doing it that matters. Those New Year resolutions that by the 2nd or 3rd of January have been slightly forgotten, or the things that we always said we were going to do that we never actually did. Well, Jesus says, you know, it's not no good just saying you're going to do it. You've actually got to do it. Secondly, he also states that having made one decision, one can always affect change in one's life by having the courage to admit that one was wrong and change course. And that's, of course, exactly what St. John the Baptist was doing to the nation of Israel, preparing for Jesus' ministry. He said, look, he said, you've been going in a certain direction. You've been looking for this Messiah. He's now arrived. Listen to him. Change your lifestyle as a result. But they didn't, by and large. They turned their backs on that ministry. It means not only having the courage to turn round in life at times and make a new start, a new decision, but it also means that we have to be self-aware enough to do that, does it not? We can set out on one path, we find it's just not for us, we have to make that change. It's having the courage to do it and be self-aware enough to see the need for that. And then new growth can certainly take place. Jesus is saying then to those who would be listening very clearly, those who think that they're part of God's big family now, but are not prepared to repent, to turn around, to change, to face new possibilities in life, they are not as close to God as those who feel they're not part of it at all, but are prepared to turn around in their lives and to admit that they've got it wrong and start again. They, he says, are closer to the kingdom of heaven than those who would profess to be doing it all, but not doing it, if you see what I mean. Promising to do it, but not doing it. Well, it leads me to a final point, and that final point came through superbly in our prayers. Because, you know, the church is challenged and has been throughout the centuries to be Christ in the world, active in the world. Faith and practice need to be alive and active enough and involved in our 21st century society. And so be, as it has been right throughout the ages, at the cutting edge of a lot of what is going on. And as a result of that, do we challenge the aspects of the messed up world in which we live at times that need a voice to challenge, need a voice to speak out for those who have no voice of their own to speak out? Will we speak out as a church and say that? And then causing others to turn to us and say, by what authority do you do this? Well, the authority by which we act as Christian peoples is the authority of Jesus. It's his commission. It's his work that we do in his name, in his world. So the answer to the critic and questioner of today is slightly different from that initial response at the beginning of the reading, but at one level, not too much, because it's quite surely and quite simply a very direct response this time that doesn't need any introduction to it, because it is a continued authority from Jesus's day through to ours, a continued opportunity to speak in word and action about Jesus, about his love, and about the new life faith, true faith, lived in his service can bring. Amen. So we sing a great hymn of faith. Now we have a gospel to proclaim as our offertory hymn, hymn number 486.
And those who are helping them. We pray